organizer of the other program that's going on this semester. This is on the geometry of polynomials. Nikhil Srivastava is going to tell us about that. It's at the intersection of theoretical computer science and mathematics.
So thanks. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about this program that we're running called Geometry of Polynomials. So this is sort of a funny name. It suggests that this is a field that has something to do with geometry or algebra, but it really is mostly having to do with analysis. So this is a term that was coined sometime in the early 20th century, and it refers to a field which studies the zeros of multivariate polynomials with complex roots. The reason it had this name is to distinguish it from algebraic geometry. There's already a huge field which studies zeros of complex polynomials, but this is about analysis. So maybe the most concrete way to tell you, you know, somehow what the themes of this field are is to just study the simplest example. So let's suppose I have a univariate polynomial P with complex coefficients and degree n. Okay. So this is something we've all seen, and basic observation is that there are three different ways of thinking about this polynomial. So the most concrete one is just to list the coefficients. So you have these n plus one numbers that are the coefficients. But then there's this other way, which is instead of writing it as a sum, you can write it as a product, and the factors in the product tell you what the zeros of the polynomial are. So this is an alternate representation in terms of zeros. And then finally, you can also just think of the polynomial as a function from complex numbers to complex numbers. So you can think of this object in three different ways. And once you have this, you can ask all sorts of questions, like what happens to one of these things when I change at some of the other ones? Right? Like if I apply some transformation of the coefficients, what happens to the zeros, and vice versa? So maybe the one of the first theorems in this area, which really is a prototype for much of what follows, is the Gauss-Lucas theorem. So this is like from 1800, something like that. And I'm just going to tell you what this theorem says with a picture. So let's suppose I have a polynomial P of z of degree 4. And let's say these are zeros in the complex plane. So now I can ask the question, well, what's going to happen when I differentiate this polynomial? Right? So that's some natural operation on the polynomial. When I differentiate a polynomial of degree 4, I'm going to get a polynomial of degree 3. So it's going to have some three other zeros. And you could ask, well, what's the relationship between the zeros of the derivative and the zeros of the original polynomial? And it turns out there's a very nice answer to this. So the Gauss-Lucas theorem says that, well, the zeros of the derivative are contained in the convex hull of the zeros of the polynomial. Okay, so that's like that's the simplest example of maybe interesting theorem in this area. But this is the type of thing that's studied in this field. You apply some transformation to one side of this picture, what happens to the other side? Okay, so this is an old field. Our program is about applying this perspective of polynomials and these transformations on polynomials and their zeros to study phenomena in computer science. The rough unifying idea of much of the research that's going on is you want to study some object like a graph, or maybe like you have some convex set or something. Well, we find some way to encode it as a multivariate polynomial. And then now this polynomial, it has coefficients, it has zeros, it has some properties as a function. And you use this interplay to prove interesting theorems about whatever it is you wrote at this polynomial. And our program has at least three different clusters of people and directions to go with this. So the first cluster is studying discrete phenomena of interest in computer science, like traditional algorithms and complexity, probability and combinatorics. I'll say more about this in a moment. The second is in statistical physics. So physicists have been using generating polynomials to describe physical systems for a long time. They're called partition functions in physics. And the third group is real algebraic geometry and optimization. So it turns out you can define all sorts of interesting convex sets in Rn using different classes of polynomials. So roughly, the reason we're having the program now is that this perspective of studying these zeros has led to major results in all three of these areas, and also to new connections between them that were sort of less clear previously. And so, given that that's the case, our program has really got three different communities of people who aren't so used to talking to each other, and one of the goals is to have is to make these connections, is to develop these connections. So let me just give you a flavor. Let me tell you three of the results recently proven by members of the program, which may be more interesting from an applications perspective, but also representative of some of the ideas. So this is something which you may already have heard a little bit about. So this is a result which shows how to sample efficiently from the basis of any matroid. Okay, so what's the problem? So you're given a matroid M, where the ground set is a set of n elements, and there's a set of bases of the matroid. If you don't know what a matroid is, just think of the set of spanning trees of a graph. Okay. So if I give you a graph on n vertices, it has exponentially many spanning trees. You're probably not given this thing as a list. You're given this as an oracle. So what that means is, given any set, you can check whether it's in this B or not. And the goal is to generate a uniformly random sample. From the set of bases of this matrix. So this captures a lot of problems that are actually used in applications. For example, determinantal point processes, if you've heard of those, they're a special case of this. And the theorem, due to Anari, Lu, Vaiskaran, and Vincent, is that the natural Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm, I won't say what it is, for sampling a random element, a random basis, mixes rapidly. Okay. So you can do this very efficiently. And again, the way this is proven is by, there's no polynomial in this question, but the way this is proven is you write down a multivariate generating function of this polynomial of this matroid. You sum over all the bases. You write down some generating function. So multivariate generating function. And then it turns out that various convexity properties of the generating function give you this result. Okay, so in this problem, your goal was to sample a random coefficient of this polynomial via a Markov chain. But somehow the reason you were able to do it was by studying its properties as a function. The second example is, which is, a different area, is algorithms for approximating partition functions. Okay, so this is something that comes from statistical physics. One example of a partition function is, let's say you're given some graph G, and the partition function is a generating function which counts some interesting structure in the graph. So I'm just going to write one on the board. Let's say you write down the partition function that counts the independent sets of the graph. So this is a polynomial of degree n, where n is the number of vertices. It's just x to the I, where I is x to the I times, let's say, mi, where mi is the number of independent sets of size I. Okay. So given a graph, you can write this generating function for its independent sets. If you could evaluate this at some interesting points, it's a way of counting, weighted way of counting the independent sets. And again, there's a sequence of results by people, several of whom are in the program. It's not a comprehensive list, saying, so the theorem is you can efficiently approximate this function for values of x that are far from the zeros of this polynomial. So again, there's this interplay. Like, our goal is to find to evaluate this polynomial, and the places where you can do it exactly have to do with where the zeros of this polynomial lie. And again, some of these algorithms are real algorithms. They're not like some other algorithms that you can't code. They actually run fast on a computer. Wait, so I have 2 minutes, including questions? Okay. Well, okay. The last one I won't describe in detail, but basically, many people may be familiar with semi-definite programming. That's optimization of a certain class of convex cones. you can view the positive definite cone as a zero free region of the determinant polynomial, a certain zero free region of a determinant polynomial. And now you can plug in a much more general class of polynomials and get a generalization of semi-definite programming called hyperbolic programming. And it's a mystery exactly how much more powerful this is than semi-definite programming. So this is a geometric question where you get a geometric object from looking at the zero free region of a polynomial. But anyway, if you're interested in this, here are a few buzzwords if you want to search on the internet. But I hope you got a sense of what the program is about. One minute for questions.
One quick question. So have the three groups you mentioned been?
The three groups have been mixing, perhaps not as rapidly as that algorithm, but they've been they've been slowly mixing. Yeah. So.
Thanks, Nikhil.